I'd like to teach the world to sing.
Sing with me.
Perfect harmony.
Perfect harmony.
I'd like to buy the world a Coke
and keep it company.
Welcome to I'm Your Target Demographic, and today we're discussing Coca-Cola, some history, some facts, and a general sense of the company. Our story begins in 1885 when a former Confederate colonel named John Pemberton created a drink that served as a replacement for morphine. He was wounded in the war and didn't want to rely on morphine, so this drink helped to ease him off of it. He pitched this drink also to help with things like nerve disorders and headaches, almost a cure-all elixir. It originally included alcohol, but with the dawn of Prohibition, Pemberton created a non-alcoholic formula. It was called Coca-Cola because it contained extract from the coca plant, which also creates the narcotic cocaine. The amount of cocaine in the early days is incredibly minimal, though. It was also present in most other medicines of the time as well. The last traces of cocaine were removed by 1929. Some of the videos I'm using here are courtesy of a Comedy Central segment of Drunk History retelling this account. Anyways, back to the origin. After Pemberton created Coca-Cola, it becomes a little confusing. Different businesses were creating the drink with various agreements with Pemberton. He owned the name Coca-Cola but allowed different manufacturers to use his formula. There wasn't much proof of any of this, mostly being verbal agreements. Eventually, the formula and the name were purchased by a businessman by the name of Asa Candler, who really launched Coca-Cola into fame and later became mayor of Atlanta, Georgia. There are several buildings and monuments in Atlanta named after him. How Candler got the rights to Coca-Cola is a little mysterious, as he was contested by Pemberton's son and another co-owner that claims her signature was forged. It's hard to know what really happened, but one tale, perhaps an urban legend, says that Candler bought the rights from John Pemberton's wife at his funeral, so that the younger Pemberton wouldn't have a chance to deny him. Let's get past all this drama. Coca-Cola began being bottled through the South, with Candler contracting out the bottling to a company in Tennessee. The home of Coca-Cola remained Atlanta, though, where Pemberton originally conceived and started selling the syrup. Coca-Cola took off with an aggressive marketing campaign from Candler throughout the early 1900s. In 1935, Coca-Cola was able to create kosher beverages, which allowed more people to enjoy. It was 1955 when the first aluminum cans of Coke were created, as opposed to the traditional glass bottles. At this time, Coke was nationally known, though it was in a heated race with its major competitor, Pepsi. Pepsi launched a nationwide campaign called the Pepsi Challenge, which was a blind taste test to prove that people preferred Pepsi over Coke. This campaign helped to get Pepsi notable interest, but Coca-Cola never lost its foothold. Across the world to this day, Coke still outsells Pepsi, though there are definite locations where Pepsi is more dominant, however rare those regions may be. With the success of Coke came offshoots like Diet Coke, Cherry Coke, Coke with Lime, and many more. In the mid-80s, they tried to launch a new Coke to better compete with Pepsi, but this was seen as a huge mistake, and it wasn't long before they reverted to their original formula. Let's talk about Coke's marketing and how they became so prominent. One of their most successful ad campaigns is a yearly campaign focused on the Christmas holiday. There's a popular theory that Coke invented the old bearded version of Santa Claus, though this theory is mostly fake. Did they invent that image? No. Did they maybe make that image popular? Possibly. Even to this day, Coke's holiday advertisements are heartfelt and notable, now with the trademark polar bears always enjoying a nice cold bottle. In the mid-80s, Coca-Cola even went as far as to purchase Columbia Pictures in order to create movies, which were often loaded with product placement. There were a few hits, like Ghostbusters, but many more flops, so Coke eventually sold the studio to Sony. More recently, they've had successful marketing efforts including the Open Happiness era, which paired a catchy jingle with a positive message, and followed up with the Share a Coke campaign, where bottles were now labeled with names, encouraging you to find bottles with your friends' names and to, as the name implies, share a Coke with them. So where do you stand? Are you a Coke person or a Pepsi person? Does their marketing work for you? Let me know all your thoughts in the comments below, and hopefully you learned something interesting.